So our next panel, the one that you joined us for, is Data-Driven Movement Building Panel. And we have quite a suite of panelists, as you'll see in a second. I don't know if this talk even needs much of an explanation, but it seems that we care so much about making an impact, making sure that we're doing the most good that we can, but some of the activities we do are just really hard to measure. It's really hard to tell whether your political campaign or whether the social movement or movement building efforts you've done are actually making an impact you'd like them to. So we have a suite of professionals here who are going to address this problem and see if in any way we can measure the impact that we're having. Would you guys like to join us to the stage? Moderating the panel, we have my colleague, Tara McCauley. She's the Chief Operating Officer at the Center for Effective Altruism. And the panelists we have with us today are from many different countries and different backgrounds. We have Chris Wiley, who makes forecasts about voter behavior, Ken Strasse, who makes high-tech statistical modeling models about political campaigns, Brett Thalman, who has over a decade of party politics experience in Canada, Sam Deer, who's done policy and communications for several Australian politicians, and Alex Avina, who's the director of McMaster University's Communication Management Program. So thank you all for joining us today.
So I'd just like to provide a little bit more context before we dive into everything here. So as many of you have heard over the course of this conference, over the last decade or so, we've seen this massive explosion in both the quantity of data available, but also the computing power and techniques being developed that help us process that data and generate insights. And one of the things that we've been most excited about is applying these sort of techniques, looking at this data and thinking about how we can drive social change, how we can apply this to movement building. And we've seen an increasing use of data all over the world, but in particular, we've now been applying this in political campaigns in the US, in Australia, in Europe, and many of our panelists can speak to how we can learn from these techniques, learn from the use of data to drive social change here, and apply that to our thoughts about growing effective altruism and ensuring that we sort of don't alienate people as we grow, that we have this message which deeply understands people, understands what drives them, and then speaks to what they care about. So, you know, I'll let the panelists all sort of, how about you just all introduce yourselves and give us a little bit of background, your expertise, and first thoughts on the panel.
Is the microphone, oh, hello, hi, can you hear me? Hi. So my name is Chris. I am a consultant. So I work in politics, but specifically in two areas, one, data analytics, and two, in behavior and voter psychology. So what I do is I help clients and campaigns essentially understand two things. One, who are the specific types of people who will engage with their message, how to engage them on that message, and then two, actually how to find those specific people in their given electorate. I've worked actually all over the world, in Europe, UK, both the United States, Canada, I'm from Canada originally, and the Caribbean and Africa. So looked at elections both from a Western and a non-Western perspective and how we can use data and the different challenges in both those scenarios. So here, I'll pass it on to Ken.
Thank you. I'm Ken Strasma. I have a firm, Haystack DNA, that I started in the political space in U.S. politics back in 2003. We worked for the John Kerry presidential campaign, and we've seen a lot of changes in the predictive analytics space. We started doing this long before big data was a buzzword that let me shorthand what we do for folks. And it's really fascinating to me how the technology has changed and also the understanding and use of the technology. Since the success of the 08 Obama campaign, where predictive analytics and micro-targeting really caught the public's fancy and got a lot of press attention, we've expanded into doing a lot more commercial work, but we are still able to spend some time where our hearts are in helping make the world a better place, including things like small donor modeling for nonprofit organizations, volunteer modeling, and a project I'm particularly proud of for the New York City Police Department, where they were struggling with their inability to communicate successfully with the community in the wake of various police brutality scandals. And we were able to have a very large sample multimodal survey and dashboard process set up for them so that they're able to measure their actual progress in improving their relationships with the community.
Hi, I'm Brett Tallman. I went to school for business and after graduating have been working in politics for the last, I think, 13 years now at various levels in the Canadian government. I work both in the opposition and in government, both provincially and federally in Canada. And 4 years ago, I joined Justin Trudeau, our now Prime Minister, when he was running for the leader of the Liberal Party, and got to work with him leading up into the campaign. And then once he won this past November, I was on his transition team going into government. And now I run what's called the Liberal Research Bureau, which is an office at the Parliament of Canada that supports all the Liberal members of Parliament trying to turn all the things we're doing in government into communication products and services so that members of Parliament can communicate effectively with the voters in their riding.
Hi, I'm Sandhya, Technical Director at CEA. So I started out my career in politics, worked in politics for a number of years, working on various election campaigns, been a digital campaign director on both state and federal campaigns, and then since then have made the switch and have gone full-blown EA, and now I'm the tech director at CEA. At the moment, I'm working on a big project trying to consolidate all of our internal data and data across the movement so that we have a better sense of how the movement's growing and how we can grow it further.
I'm Alex Sevigny, and as Roxanne mentioned, I'm a professor of communications and communications management at McMaster University in Hamilton, Ontario. I also run our Master of Communications Management program, which combines sort of public relations, marketing, government relations, other aspects of communications from a business and management perspective. Brett, I've also worked in liberal politics in the Canadian arena, mostly in Ontario, worked on several campaigns. Now I have the pleasure of working with Brett as on research and insights to support the effort in terms of communicating with the public. One of the things I've noticed as a researcher and as a professor of comms management is that communications has gone from a field that was really intuition-driven to a field that suddenly has a wealth of data available, but not a lot of structure or theory that enables the practitioners or managers to interpret those data, which is a challenge because it's a question of connecting insight and analysis that exists with the practitioners who can put it into action.
So exciting, I can't wait to hear from all of you. It's hard to know where to even start, but let's jump in with Ken. So you were National Targeting Director for the Obama campaign and then after that Bernie Sanders, and I guess this really speaks to how we're combining data with social impact. So can you talk us through the campaign, what you learned, like some interesting things, and how you sort of really managed to engage voters and figure out what they care about?
Sure. As I alluded to introducing myself, we've seen an awful lot of change in the predictive analytics micro-targeting space. Obviously, computers are faster, storage is much cheaper. We can store volumes of data we never would have conceived of 10 years ago. New algorithms are being invented all the time. So on the purely technical end, things are getting a lot faster, a lot better. But I think the more important watershed moment in the 08 campaign for Barack Obama was that the technology was accepted and understood from top to bottom. When we started doing this for the John Kerry campaign, we had very successful modeling, trying to model supporters and persuade polls, but it was largely viewed as this directive from the DC headquarters, and it wasn't really well integrated into the campaigns. I've often commented that I thought my Republican colleagues had things a little easier because they were used to having a top-down command and control type structure. And for me, on the left side of the political spectrum, we're a lot more, let's have a meeting and form consensus and share our feelings, not you know, take an order from Karl Rove, which, you know, is, you know, on the one hand, that's, you know, part of what I love about, you know, being on the left side of the political spectrum. But on the other hand, it made it harder to, you know, just have something that was taken as a directive from D.C. and work. But by the time the Obama campaign rolled around 4 years later, a lot of the people that we had worked with in the Iowa caucuses for Kerry, who were, you know, 19 or 20-year-old county organizers, had gone on to be running congressional campaigns, running states for the Obama campaign. So there were suddenly these people who had come up in the political process using micro-targeting and predictive analytics, and they understood what it was about. And so percolating up from the end user side, and then also, you know, David Plouffe, the campaign manager, really understood what it was about and you know, was very, very much engaged in it. Jumping forward eight years later to the Bernie Sanders campaign, where, you know, I thought we had a very exciting campaign, and, you know, he got a lot farther than many people expected that he would be able to, largely based on turning out a new and different electorate. So we had some new challenges trying to find voters who were generally young, oftentimes were first-time voters, so people who wouldn't be on a traditional commercial database, so we had to find ways of getting information about them. We also were able to model things that we hadn't been modeling before. You know, we had a lot of success in fundraising modeling and volunteer modeling, which was really a backbone of the Sanders campaign, is just a lot of people very actively volunteering, and so different states would, you know, be able to use models to know who to ask. And as I'm sure anyone who was following the campaign heard, you know, he had an average contribution of $27. So finding the people who were interested in engaging on a low dollar level was very important and very successful. There are also things on the peer implementation side, like the advent of addressable television, that allowed us to target television ads to individuals in a way that that didn't exist four years ago. And I would happily waste all of our time talking about the fun things we did, but I won't be selfish.
Interesting. So Alex and Brett, you guys then built on a lot of this, and they did the same thing with Trudeau recently in Canada. And you were telling me before about some of the interesting strategies that you used to help get data from people who attended in-person events and feed that into analytics. Can you speak on that?
Yeah, I think in Canada we had the benefit that our election was following a successful Obama election, so we were able to take a lot of the tools and strategies that were used here in the States and apply them in Canada. And one of our big efforts was to build a large volunteer team across the country that were gathering data door-to-door, talking to their neighbors, finding out what issues they care about and what motivated them to vote. And that, so we had all of that data kind of feeding in to our central database that we could look at on a day-to-day basis at headquarters. And we'd match that up with, you know, all the polling data that we'd see kind of at the national and regional level. And we could see kind of, you know, what anomalies were appearing, you know, what was resonating in terms of our message through the campaign. And that, you know, I think really was effective. And the other part of it was all the social media that we were able to do. You know, just given Justin Trudeau's profile, he was very engaging on social media, and a lot of young people really came towards the cause to join the campaign and volunteer. I think that really set things out.
Alex, can you think of any like particular examples where the data showed you something that was like pretty unintuitive and caused you to take a different action than you would have naively? Or how about any of you?
Well, so I guess it wasn't really that it was data-driven, but it was about data. So one of the kind of surprising things for me during the campaign was as Justin Trudeau would travel across the country and have speeches, one of the big applause lines was around bringing back the long-form census in Canada, because the previous administration had gotten rid of it. And it was really the kind of the research scientific community that, when that decision was made, really got active and created a space for us on, in the political spectrum to advocate for that. So we committed to that in our campaign, along with bringing back evidence-based policymaking in government. And so I think that was a big surprise that, you know, that was a big applause line, which I don't think I would have expected otherwise.
Yeah, and it's quite interesting with you know, in a lot of other countries, we're seeing this shift away from the use of evidence and reason, a lot of narrative-driven messaging coming out in the election. So what do you think was, like, different about Canada? Why was Trudeau able to succeed based on this campaign of evidence and data for informing policy?
Well, I think one of the things that you saw during the lead up to the election was a lot of groups that worked with evidence, or, you know, scientists, for example, were quite organized and quite vocal. So there was a history in the previous administration of not allowing scientists to share their results freely or within the federal government, for example, an attitude towards data, which was much more closed than open, right? And so there were groups, advocacy groups among the concerned citizens, as well as professionals who work with data, who laid a groundwork and already started media narratives, I think, that the campaign was able to key in on and cultivate and then turn into key messages and platform promises that resonated with groups that had thought through and were already laying the groundwork.
Chris, you have a lot of interesting thoughts on this.
Yeah, I was just to your can you hear? Oh, okay, there we go. Just on your question about sort of counterintuitive examples. So this is not in Canada, but I've worked on several campaigns in the UK. One interesting anecdote that I can think of is looking at attitudes towards immigration. It's a big issue in the UK right now. But one of the findings that we had looking at immigrants as a potential target cohort of people was that there were particularly older immigrants actually had more skepticism towards looser immigration controls because they had to go through all of the processes, and if I had to jump through all these hoops, why should this guy get a free ride? And that without actually looking and engaging that particular cohort of people, we wouldn't have understood that actually just because you are an immigrant doesn't mean that you are indeed pro-immigration.
Right. So tell us about Brexit.
Brexit's a lot. So where to begin with Brexit? I think in terms of, you look, Brexit's an interesting example for effective altruists because you had an entire expert community, if you will, making many warnings about, is something, the economy is going to, have detrimental impacts with this, And when Remain did a lot of their research, they would ask people, okay, can you list off, like, what are the most important issues for this referendum? And people often would say the economy. One of the things that I think Remain didn't quite realize was that it was a socially rehearsed answer. So when you ask people about abstract questions that they're not always thinking about, they'll just sort of give something that feels correct, but they don't necessarily engage it actively in their head. When you actually go out and speak with a lot of the target cohorts of voters that swung the referendum to leave, a lot of these people hadn't been employed for a long time, or they had family members who weren't actively engaged in the economy. And so when you had the Remain campaign coming out with all these experts talking about this is going to be bad for the economy, the swing group of voters weren't as actively engaged in that economy, and it came across as this is the economy for wealthy Londoners, this is the economy for bankers, the economy for PR execs, but my factory closed and moved to Romania, I'm not part of the economy that you're talking about. And it's a lesson in understanding that just because you ask a question and you get an answer, it doesn't necessarily mean that that answer isn't necessarily what you think it means. And that it's important to really actually go a lot deeper in investigating that question, which is actually where qualitative research and quantitative research, I think, can overlap. I know a lot of people, I'm a data scientist, I know a lot of you guys are probably data scientists too. So, looking at qualitative methods is that, it's not generalizable, et cetera. But actually going and speaking to your target cohort and really actually speaking to them and understanding, oh, you don't even see the economy as something that you are part of, you can then actually start to develop more hypotheses that you wouldn't have otherwise had. And I think Brexit is a real lesson in improving research methods so that unexpected results don't necessarily happen in the future. Because the entire point of data science in politics is to know what's going to happen so that you can develop strategy around it.
Yeah, that's interesting. It sounds like you're saying that some of the older tools, like phone surveys, might yield answers that don't quite tell us what people care about.
Oh, absolutely. There is a crisis in polling right now.
Right.
And I am very skeptical of polling because, when polling, was first invented in the UK, it was back in the 40s and 50s and really sort of became a mainstay of political campaigns in the 60s onward. You had response rates of upwards of 50%. So, that moving down towards, in some cases, below 5% when you actually go and call people now, you are getting a sample of people who are either have time to talk to a random person on the phone about their opinions or, are so opinionated that they want to talk about it. And particularly with young people now, they're not answering their phone. Even if you go and try to call their mobile, they're not answering their phone. So you end up skewing.
So what data sources tell us what people like really care about and break through that?
Does somebody else? I've hogged time, so.
Just briefly back to the NYPD project we did, where one of the primary goals was finding out the attitudes of young African American males, and it's a group that was very cautious about speaking to NYPD police officers. Because of the tensions with the community, very unlikely to have landlines, and very unlikely to answer traditional surveys. There, I don't believe that there's going to be any one thing that replaces telephone surveys the way telephone surveys basically replaced the initial door-to-door survey. I think that multimodal surveying is the and also passive data collection are the waves of the future. So for the NYPD project, we had a combination of automated robocalls, live calls. Text message surveys, promoted tweet surveys, digital online surveys, and street intercepts. And so by combining all of those together, we were able to get our sufficient sample size in every one of the police precincts. There is no way we could have done that with any one thing, especially not with just robocalls to landlines.
Right, interesting. And Sam, I guess you've been applying a lot of these techniques recently to the EA movement. And so what sort of lessons do you think we can take from these successes in politics, and how can we translate them?
So I think the things that we should, the successes should tell us that data collection is obviously incredibly important. We need to make sure that we are collecting the right data. I think the thing that I often saw back when I was in politics was, and certainly drawing on the experience of the Obama campaign, was you would have local politicians who saw what was happening with Obama, saw what was happening in these big data-driven kind of election campaigns and said, we should do this, and then just didn't invest. So I think part of it is about making sure that you invest properly in collecting this data, that it's not just a matter of just collecting the vanity metrics, just plugging in Google Analytics and hoping that it's going to tell you something, but actually drilling down into the things that are actually going to tell you something about your movement and moving. Yeah, so drawing, I guess, from the drawing from what these kinds of campaigns have done in spirit, which is taking really high quality data sets and gleaning lessons from them, but looking at your local context. And I think in EA, obviously, every organization is going to have its own local context. It's going to have its own metric that's important. And so, taking the spirit of that, but then looking at what we can actually do in our local context.
Interesting. So I guess I'll ask the rest of you, since you've done so much profiling work, what do you think the profile of the effective altruism community is right now? How would you target a message towards this community here? Sure.
Hi, me again. So if you look at this is just me talking with a lot of people here, but I suspect that people here are very high in openness, which is a personality trait. Particularly a facet called intellectualism, which is different from IQ. It means you're just simply willing to engage with new ideas and you like that. That's a small part of the population. So I think the people here in this room are a niche group. In terms of broadening the appeal, there are people out there who would have similar profiles, maybe not in the same the exact same profile. But I think what data can help this movement do is understand what is unique about the people here. And my intuition is that it's a high degree of openness, and then who else in the population matches that profile. So, you know, immediately that comes to mind, university professors and all of that, you can't win just with, you know, just at universities, broadening it out, but there are open-minded people out there. So in terms of, you know, practical things, collecting data about people and looking for, there might be particular occupations, there might be particular websites or Facebook pages or tweets or things like that that people have in common. And if you identify that, then you can go and find people who do that that you've never talked to before.
Right. But so in politics, you're trying to get voters to take like a single action at a set time. You just need to like mobilize them to get them to the booth. And obviously you want engagement over time. But do you think that that might be different from what we're doing with EA, where we want a lifetime commitment?
Sure, I mean, I'll weigh in on that. I mean, I think when you're trying to build a movement that is uniting people around a common interest that is that can be quite diffuse, right? What you're doing is you're building relationships among people, right? And you're building community. And for the longest time, those were things that were very difficult to measure. I mean, there were models for modeling and measuring relationship strength, but they were difficult to scale. And now that possibility is upon us, right? And knowing the strength of the relationships between existing members those data are available on via people's social interactions or interactions within proprietary communities like chat boards or whatever, discussion fora. But then finding where once you understand your community really, really well, what its feature set is, you have to make sure that you find intersections with other groups, right? And because it's very easy to find a set of features which define the space in which you guys operate, the members of EA operate, but then have that become an echo chamber or a sort of self-fulfilling prophecy in terms of who might be solicited to join. Where movements really pick up steam is when you develop stories and narratives and themes that inspire the members of the movement, are very familiar to them, that impassion them, but then also send them out into the world to recruit people who are actually quite different, but who might share one feature or two or three with members. And there's rhetorical power in that, there in that storytelling function, that ability to talk about successes, but not only successes, also talk about the fulfillment that one gets from the relationships one builds within the organization. Because that really is it's the emotional appeal and the sort of relationships that people build and the human capital, the emotional capital, the social capital that they gain from being part of it, that is gonna sell it to a wider audience.
And I also, I think, just another random example. I worked on a campaign where we had a very pro-environments candidate, and one of the cohorts that we ended up engaging were evangelical Christians who traditionally are very socially conservative, and what we found was that we could engage them on environmental issues in the context of respecting God's creation in language and in frameworks that they understood. And I think when you explore different kinds of populations, you might actually find different kinds of allies and different groups that can be allied with you that aren't necessarily just pure rationalists, or university professors or data scientists, but might engage with your ideas for slightly different reasons.
I think it's also important to remember we set quite a high standard in this community for evidence, for the kind of commitment that we'd like people to have. We'd like people to give significantly. We'd like people to make significant changes with their careers. And so I think risk is if people are focusing on the wrong data and the wrong metrics,
then one risk is that you're going for large numbers rather than good quality numbers. And so I'm president of Giving What We Can, and our membership number is one of the most important numbers, and we see it go up very, very slowly. You know, it's one, two, three, four members a day, but each of those members is incredibly important because they've made such a big lifetime commitment. And so I think it's worth remembering that the numbers that you track aren't always the numbers that grow fastest. They're not always the numbers that are the most kind of salient when you're sort of looking at these charts go up sort of exponentially. But remembering which ones are actually speaking to the core values, and if we are to retain these high standards that we're trying to have as a movement, remembering that those are the things that we need to be measuring, rather than going for something which lowers the bar. But then looks like the stats are going up.
Yeah, it seems like a controversial issue, though. There's this tension. Like, we can certainly do a lot more good if we engage more people, as long as they're aligned on the specific action that we want them to take. Say, perhaps with a different message, we could get a lot more donations to effective charities without causing anyone to self-identify as an effective altruist. Mm-hmm. Is that still good for the long-run future? We'll need data to figure it out, I guess. So a couple of questions from the audience I'll ask. So the audience is very keen to hear about some practical advice you can share for people out here working on movement building and working on small grassroots projects with sort of limited resources and maybe not as tech savvy as some of you. So any thoughts?
Well, yeah, so in terms of what we found to be successful in the Canadian context, especially as we built the movement, was providing people with tangible actions that they can take at different levels of the scale. So some people only have a certain amount of time, so you want to make sure the barrier to entry to kind of join the movement and participate is fairly low, but that there's a kind of a ladder of engagement that they can then rise up as they take specific actions. I think that was a key part, kind of give that flexibility and allow people to stay engaged leading up to the campaign, at least for us.
When you have events, there's something called single sign-on. So if you have an online landing page, if you're hosting an event, the cool thing about single sign-on is when people use it, you can collect certain pieces of data about those people. Obviously, they have to consent to it. But just in a very practical sense, you might find that, for example, if you use Facebook to sign in and you look at what are the most common Facebook likes of people who are coming to my events, and then maybe use that in terms of targeting Facebook ads to reach out to people who haven't attended your event but have a similar like profile to the people that you're currently engaging with.
It's interesting, that ties into the next question, where sort of we're wondering about with an EA movement with only a couple of thousand people, a lot of the tools we're talking about here, big data and machine learning, might not be applicable to this small data set. So how do you think we can generate useful insights with only a limited amount of data? Sam,
speaking. I mean, I think probably the biggest thing is to just really value the membership data that you have. It's often, I think, in these contexts, we think we look at the political campaigns and we're looking at these huge numbers that we're driving from lots of microsites all around, lots of passive data collection. But I think for mine, the most powerful things that we can do are consolidate some of the data that we have across the organization. What we often see is siloing of data across the organization, so different people using different spreadsheets, different people using different tools to analyze data. And it turns out a lot of this data is actually in the organization. You just need it to interface with each other. So I think, and this also touches on your previous question about what are practical tips. I think having things that are really easy for people to use and making sure people have bought into them, making sure that everyone's using the same system, making sure that the system that you're using is, you can get the data out of it again and use it in a different context are all really important things. So from a practical standpoint, I think those are very important.
The audience is also keen to hear about how we can communicate data-driven messages in a world where it seems the audience is less and less interested in data and the numbers, like we've seen with Brexit and climate change. Ken, would you like to speak on that?
When this came up in our discussions before, climate change is immediately what sprang to mind for me, where you have a whole wing of the argument whose argument is we can't trust the scientists on this. I wish I knew the answer to that. From my particular lens of using predictive analytics for this type of issue, I know there are some subgroups, suburban economic conservatives who are concerned about the environment and do believe in science and are open to a message on that. I'm frankly still struggling myself for the bigger picture about how do you successfully argue with a group that is saying that the expert opinion is incorrect and that that's a cornerstone of their argument, is that the experts are trying to pull the wool over your eyes. And there has been a fair amount of research that a more empathetic and Socratic type of debate is much better than trying to present facts to that sort of people, because if you've already decided that the experts are wrong, you're not going to believe any number of facts that you're given.
If any of you in the audience had that experience when trying to talk about an RCT? No. So I guess the thing that always comes up whenever we discuss collecting all this data, trying to get email addresses and social media profiles, is privacy as well. And if we're talking about doing this on the EA community, how can we sort of balance the two sides of that?
There's a lot of different ways. I think, okay, so firstly, I think it's important to point out that insight and privacy are not polar opposites. And people often talk about privacy in terms of a trade-off. I don't think it's a trade-off. I think you can have privacy and insight at the same time. Just as a really specific example, if you're collecting information, you can hold what's called PII, personally identifiable information, so that's like people's names or things that would identify them as a person, separately from other pieces of information, so occupations, et cetera, and link them through, you can have hashed databases, or you can link them through different ID numbers such that when you model it, you don't need to know that this is Joe Smith in New York in order to model the data that you know about him. You simply need to know that there is a male in New York who has this income and this occupation, and extract the insight that you want, how likely are they to support cause X or Y, and then link that inference that you make back to the actual identity. In that case, you as the modeler never actually really touch a person's information where it's linked to their identity. The only thing that you link is the insight back to their identity. And in that way, you can have a large-scale data science operation. You can have insight and extract information from data, whilst at the same time respecting the privacy of people.
The audience is also very curious how we put this into practice. So they want to know what this analytics pipeline looks like, how you collect data, analyze it, and generate insights. Are there any particular techniques you recommend, software?
A great thing about the software is how inexpensive and accessible it is compared to when I first started doing this. And there would be commercial packages costing tens of thousands of dollars, and now, with R or packages in Python and other things like that, it's freely downloadable and also much more rapidly updated than some of the old commercial packages. If someone invents something, a new algorithm, it's shared and available far quicker than the commercial software development cycle would allow. So the barriers of entry for someone wanting to do it themselves for their own organization are much, much lower. I would say my number one piece of advice for someone wanting to get started doing this, especially on a smaller organization, is just to collect all the data you have. Save everything, even if you're not sure what it's going to be useful for. And the main thing is to save stuff that you think isn't useful, like save unsuccessful prospects. Very often an organization will come to me and say, here's my 2,000 members, can you model them? And yes, I can model those 2,000, and what I'm going to come up with is reverse engineering who you chose to ask, because that's what your list comes from. If instead of just being able to provide those 2,000, you can provide those 2,000 and the 8,000 people you asked but didn't join the organization, that's much, much more powerful. And that's a sort of non-intuitive thing that, because it hasn't been valuable to an organization before, they've never thought to save that sort of thing. And so now, especially with computer storage being so cheap, save everything until you figure out what you're going to do with it.
I think another sort of really basic but and infrastructural thing that you can do that's sort of even pre-analytics, I mean, obviously, it's to channel people's behaviors and communications onto channels that they know and trust, right? And it kind of goes to what you were saying. And also to the privacy issue, if you're communicating via software or communicating via a mechanism that everybody's familiar with, understands, and knows, understands the agreement that they've come into with the organization when they sign on and start to participate in the conversation, you get greater openness and as well a much more well-structured and easy to parse data set, right? So I mean, just getting people's behavior, like channeling people towards particular venues rather than having, you know, more dispersed venues.
Yeah, so with all this data collection, I guess we're thinking about tracking lots of different things, and it's interesting. So like, what's the one key metric that you think we should focus on for building effective altruism or any other movement? If you could just pick one. Brett?
I would say it's kind of the membership and the volunteers that are engaged in the movement. I think, at least for us, you know, you have a large number of people involved, you can ask them all to take an action collectively. And something that, you know, worked really well for us was we'd have, you know, at the beginning, it was small groups of people meeting, talking about issues, and even the simple ask of, okay, well, our next meeting is 2 weeks away, everyone bring one new person to this meeting, so we will double the size of the group for the next time. Stuff like that is something easy thing people can do that will really, you know, you'll end up getting exponential growth out of it because everyone's taking that action together.
I think successful movements and successful organizations are based on relationships, and there's a lot of research on what drives relationships and what makes for successful relationships, particularly within an organization, between an organization and its stakeholders. But the two key elements are probably, particularly in the not-for-profit sector, are probably trust and control mutuality. So the amount of shared control that members feel that they have when they participate in an event or participate in an action, right? Those are tricky things to measure, but there are ways.
So does that mean that, say, for voters, they want to know that their opinions and thoughts matter and that you change your platform on the basis of that?
Mm-hmm.
Right. And yes. How do you think we can apply that to EA?
Well, I mean, there are lots of ways. One means is to make sure that when decisions are made, they're widely tested amongst the membership. Another, I don't know the specifics of how the organization operates, so because I'm sort of new to the organization, having been invited to, and this is sort of my introduction, right? So forgive me if I make a suggestion that seems obvious to you, but. Just making sure that things are as sort of, to use a cliche, crowdsourced or as widely agreed upon as possible, and that people have multiple ways of gaining access to decision making, and also multiple ways of gaining access to controlling their own implication in an organization. So what events they are required to participate in, or different modes of participation versus what they want to participate, or the ways in which they want to participate.
Right. Yeah. So we can engage audiences better by giving them lots of different actions that they can take to contribute at lots of different scales.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
It's interesting. Yeah. So what do you think EA is currently doing wrong? How are we like less engaging than we could otherwise be? How might we be misunderstanding our users or turning people off?
I will, and I'll be the one to answer the question. This is my first time here. Most of us on the panel is our first time here. I think one of the things that I've noticed attending some of the different panels and discussions and whatnot about effective altruism and get it, you guys want to have either governments with policies that are starting with data and starting with facts and measured with data, or you want programs, whether it's a government program or a not-for-profit program, that is designed and measured and, you know, evolves with data. One of the things that I've noticed is that there's a lot of discussion about how to sort of supply information, or what kind of information can you use. The thing that I think might be missing from the conversation, which is intuitive, I think, for people who work in politics, is how do you create demand for it? Because you can have as much data and information out there, but if there isn't demand on the decision-making side, so, you know, a politician, for example, then it won't go anywhere. You'll have a great report, you'll have a great data set, but it won't actually go anywhere. The best way to create demand, in my view, is to look at what do these decision makers, who do they pay attention to? And just from my general experience working with politicians, they don't always pay as much attention to data or facts or reports as maybe they should. They pay attention to what are constituents saying, what are voters saying. And this is why I think looking at data and outreach beyond conferences, actually going out and speaking with people who vote, you know, engaging with a political party is important, because if you don't generate the demands of the people who make politicians do things, who make decision makers do things, there's a risk that you provide a lot of information, a lot of facts that sort of sit collecting dust. And I think, you know, it is possible to do. There's a lot of talents I've noted just having gone around talking to people. There's a lot of people who, you know, have programming or data science backgrounds. And I'm sure that, you know, you guys can self-organize to form some kind of group that looks at, you know, who are we in terms of data and profiling, and what kinds of people likely would also want to engage with us, and then go and reach out to those people.
So you're saying we should ask decision makers what they're interested in, rather than trying to beat them over the head with the
job? Yeah, well, and I'll tell you, so politicians will, you know, blather on about, you know, they're interested in issue X or what, but what they're actually interested in is getting elected and maintaining, right? So, you know, this is how politics works. And so if you want someone to really listen to you, go to the people who can hire or fire them. And that's voters, right? And this is what direct political action is all about. You go engage people, bring them onto your movement, and then you'll have members of Congress and senators and whomever listening to what you want to say.
Alex, you want to speak on this?
Yeah, I mean, an example of that was one of the things that the Trudeau campaign did very well with scientists, actually, right? And also, what happened was there was outreach to the scientific community. The scientific community recognized that there was a challenge in not being able to communicate results, right? And not being able to communicate or share data sets or other practices that they used to participate in. And what that translated in was a common ground around the census, I think, right? I mean, because the census was a data collection mechanism, the long-form census was a data collection mechanism that the population understood, which is, you know, speaks to Chris's point. And, you know, when you have a group of scientists who are advocating for a particular, for their point of view, which is, I mean, we want greater openness, sharing of data, we want the ability to publish again and to speak to media, et cetera, a great way to get the population excited was through this touch point, right? Which made sense and resonated with a lot of people, right? And the media liked the story, I think. It as Brett described it, it resonated extremely well at campaign events, and it worked, right? So I think the key is, as a group of scientists, engaged scientists, is to find ways of building narratives, advocacy narratives, right? And having touch points that resonate with the population, the people who hire and fire politicians.
Yeah, it sounded like the lesson there was to find the thing that these two groups have in common, mm-hmm. what both the scientists and the voters can agree on.
Right.
I think we can all take a lot from that. So just Finally, any closing thoughts? What do you think EA can learn from this, or what lessons should we take away?
Should I start again? I will start again. I think what you guys do is great. I am, you know, I work with math and data all day. I work in politics, so I do, you know, care about what's happening in the world, and that is, you know, what effective altruism is all about. I think in terms of developing a mindset to more pointed action would be, I think, great to see. And looking and learning the lessons of political campaigns, because political campaigns, all we do is go out and try to make particular policies happen and engaging people to vote in people so that particular things can happen. And you know, looking at effective altruism, you want evidence-informed, you know, policy, have an evidence-informed campaign. And evidence informs outreach. And you know, there's a lot of talented people here, so I'm sure you guys can, you know, organize and go out and do it. Much more so than other organizations, I think. There's a lot of intellectual talent here.
I better let someone else give some closing thoughts. Anyone else want to chime in before we run out of time?
I'd like to give just some practical advice. I think start collecting data early. Start thinking sort of holistically about how you can collect data, and start getting everyone in your organization brought in as early as possible, collecting data consistently, collecting data in the same way, because it's much harder to retrofit these kinds of things. That's the project that I'm embarking on right now, is taking an organization that's been around for 5 years and has data in like 20 different places, and then turn that into something that's useful internally and also useful for the movement as a whole. And I think as people start to start new organizations or work with these existing organizations, getting your data collection practices, standardizing them, getting buy-in from people, making it as easy as possible for everyone in the organization, not just the person who's championing the data collection, but everyone in the organization, getting that buy-in so that everyone is putting in the data that you need to collect.
Fantastic. I mean, I would echo that. I mean, what we saw, you know, because we have, you know, 338 ridings across Canada, it was very important for us that each one of those ridings cared about the data collection and understood how it would benefit them. So in terms of EA chapters and other organizations across the world, ensuring that people understand kind of the feedback loop and why it's so important, and having some early wins of like early on, giving something back that comes out of the data so that people can really see it tangibly, and then it'll, you know, have a virtuous circle of more data will actually get collected and you'll be able to gain more insights.
I'd speak from my perspective as a communications professor and researcher, communications management. There's a community of people that can be of enormous help and in terms of getting the message out, and that is the community of communicators, professional communicators. The challenge that I think your group may have in dealing with them is that they're incredibly math phobic in general, right? And that's probably an understatement, right? And yet it's a field for which, you know, there now are rapidly evolving and available analytics and mathematical models and others, right? So finding a way to, and taking the time to, interface with communications professionals, and you know, being patient, and in terms of bringing them along and making them understand the value of data and evidence in what they do, and how that can inform intuition and help them evaluate campaigns, I think would be mutually beneficial.
And my closing thought was very much along the lines of what Alex said. The technology of predictive models and crunching data is to the point where I really think the not the brain drain, but the dearth of talent is in the people who understand the data, are able to communicate what it's telling us and turn it into strategies, as opposed to just from an academic point of view, understanding what the models or the equations are showing. And so people who have a foot in both camps, who are able to understand the data, what it can and can't do, but also are able to think strategically about, you know, what questions do I want to ask and model, and what am I going to do with these results, that's really what's going to be valuable and in demand, and where I think this organization can play an extremely valuable role.
Thank you. I think the main message I took away from this panel is it sort of surprised me a bit, and it's one of humility. I think we've heard a lot about how in political campaigning and targeting, we're sort of withholding judgment, not assuming that we understand what our audience cares about and what it is that's driving voters. We're sort of waiting and seeing what the data tells us. And it's like quite surprising to me that as effective altruists who have this focus on evidence and reason, that that's the message that we need to hear. But I think this is an area that we can improve on a lot. We can collect better data, we can monitor how people respond to our messages, and then that's how we're going to have a much greater impact. So I'd like to thank all of our panelists for a really interesting session. Thank you.